Eric Acha. Is that the correct pronunciation? I think I got that, it.
You got it, my man.
Beautiful, beautiful. Owner and founder of Peninsula Self Defense. Jean-Jacques Machado, black belt, extraordinaire. Yes. And former man of the police force of over 20 years of service.
Yes.
And was that in Redwood City?
Yeah, I did 12 years in Redwood City. And then I did 9 years at San Mateo County DA's office.
Wow. So that's a lot of work right there. It'd be very interesting, I'm sure.
I've done my time in prison.
I'm hopefully on the outside. Hopefully on the outside. Sounds like a different show. So, jiu-jitsu, I saw you had a really great video you guys just produced for you and for the academy that just popped up online on Facebook and YouTube and stuff, and it kind of broke down your story and sort of where you came from, your law enforcement, you know, background, and how you got into jiu-jitsu and how you opened your academy and eventually split from your original professor and kind of had to do it on your own and eventually with Jean-Jacques. It's an awesome video. I'd like to kind of go back to the beginning of it and sort of, let's say, you're in your law enforcement career, and where did jiu-jitsu come from? At what point did jiu-jitsu become a thing in your life?
Sure. I'm a lifelong martial artist. I've always done stand-up. In 1989, I got my black belt in Kempo. I was a senior in high school at the time. And in 1994, 5 years after that, I became a cop. So you're talking mid-90s. It's the rise of the UFC. You're reading Black Belt magazine. I've been reading it since I was a little kid. I mean, who doesn't, right? And I'm starting to see these Gracies about this jiu-jitsu, about these skinny guys from Brazil with these cool belts with all these stripes on it, and they're just choking people out. And you read about this, and you hear about Chuck Norris and how he talks about the Gracies, and you just keep hearing these things, and you're going, you know, as a martial artist, it kind of piques your interest. So I said, okay, you know, I'm going to find out more about this. So I think it was maybe 2000 or 2001. I said, you know what? Let me go check this out. So I went to Half Gracie in Mountain View. That was my first official jiu-jitsu school.
Trial by fire.
Yeah. I got thrown in the deep end very quick. Batata, I remember, had just come from Brazil. He had just landed, and he was teaching over there. And I remember seeing Cameron Earl was there. I think he might have been a purple. I think Dave Camarillo and them were purple belts or purple or brown belts or something there. Tom Cicero, I remember, was a purple belt, and I rolled with him. Tom's a black belt now, and he has a school here in San Jose. And I remember rolling with Tom. I'd never grappled. You have to kind of picture my mindset, right? So I've done stand-up. I'm this black belt, and I'm a so-so black belt in Kempo Karate. And then I've never wrestled. I've never done anything, and I get thrown into Half Gracie Mountain View. It was a grinder. I had never gotten my butt kicked like that ever. And you walk out, and one of two things happens, and I still see this now. You either embrace it or you make excuses for it.
So to people that don't know, in this area, I mean, everybody kind of knows who Dave Camarillo is. Everybody knows who Half Gracie is. Batata is a huge name. He's a world champion. He's back into competing again now. But Cameron Earl, people know him kind of for some not so great reasons.
Right.
But Tom Cicero, his school produces some notoriously tough and aggressive guys.
Yes.
Their style is no joke at all. It's a grinder, very similar to Kurt Osiander's Half Gracie SF school. So
yes, very much so.
How many times would you say you were tapped in that first meeting with Mr. Cicero?
Oh, it wasn't even funny. I couldn't even remember. I don't even think I finished the roll. I think I made an excuse and I like crawled off the mat. And I remember there was a sign in the bathroom that said, you know, if you're going to throw up, please throw up in the toilet, not in the sink.
This is a very valid sign for a jiu-jitsu school.
So I leave there and I come a couple more times. And I remember Crosley was there. He's a brown belt. I remember Crosley was still a brown belt when I was training there. Excuse me. So I leave there and then I start thinking, man, this just isn't working for me. I'm not getting, you know, any instruction. Basically, I just got my butt handed to me. I mean, it was, you know, and so I'm thinking, all right, well, what do I do? So I do what a guy who can't fit in does. He goes and finds another school, so I end up going to Charles Gracie now.
Okay.
Now I go to Charles Gracie. I'm thinking, okay, this may be more of my speed. They're a little bit more mellow, and I'm still looking to learn. So I'm looking at it from the educational aspect instead of just getting my butt handed to me. So I end up at Charles, and I remember going to Charles, and there was this guy, and he looked like a frail old man. His name is Harold Thortheson.
Okay.
Harold got his black belt from Marco Nascimento at 67 years old at the time. He was only a blue belt. He's an amazing, amazing guy. And I'm thinking, finally, somebody I can tap. I look at this frail old man on the mat kind of stretching, and I roll with him. He tapped me out 7 times in 6 minutes. He choked me so hard that I ran outside to throw up in the parking lot. It was horrible. And Harold became one of my dear friends. And that's the introduction to jiu-jitsu. And when you're handed a plate like that, and again, I told you one of two things happens. You either embrace it or you make excuses. And I finally hit the point where I said, you know what? I can't make excuses anymore. I am deficient and I need to work on this. And I don't know if you know, but you can't tell a cop anything.
I've heard.
they're the worst. And you know, and I was one of them. I'll be the first to admit, you can't tell me anything. My answer was, every time I'd get tapped or something, I'd just shoot the guy. I'd just pull out my gun, I'd just shoot him. This is not gonna work, I'm just gonna shoot him. And you know, and that's the ego getting in the way of so many things. And that happened to me, my goodness, probably 18 months, for a year and a half. I kept trying to look around, move around, go places. I started at Halfs, I went to Charles, then I ended up training a little bit with Michael Jen.
Oh yeah.
Smash gyms. Yes. I trained with Michael. I trained in the garage with Michael with Rudy and with Rudy Sanchez and Mario. And they're both black belts now. And I believe they each run one of the gyms. One of the Smash gyms.
Isn't Michael Jen? I think he's something like a fourth degree black belt or something.
Michael at the time was just a black belt, but he's a fourth degree black belt now with Joe Moreira, I believe.
Yeah. He's another one of these gems in the Bay Area that you don't. I mean, because there are so many great instructors, and not just in California, but even concentrated in this area. So there's a lot of these guys that just sort of fly under the radar because, you know, maybe they're not as loud as some of the others, but or don't have an MMA team to sort of sort of carry the name through the wind as much, but you know, he's solid as well.
But yeah, Michael's very solid, and you know, I've got nothing but respect for him. As a matter of fact, next week he's asked me to help him out during a grand opening of one of his new schools here in Milpitas. So Smash is opening up another location, so big shout out to Michael.
This is 3 now, right?
3 or 4, I'm not sure. I know there's one
Sunnyvale.
There's Sunnyvale, there's San Jose. I think this may be 3.
Okay.
This may be the 3rd location, which is amazing from a business perspective. So,
Especially in this area, there's a lot of schools that have tried to branch out from just 1 to 2, and you see it last for a little while, but not every neighborhood is ready. And right. I mean, you need the right combination of sort of instructors, and it's expanding these businesses is not an easy thing.
No, it's not, and it takes much, much more than just a black belt or a black belt or backing from someone or a name, you know, behind you. It takes much, much more to be able to develop a school, and it takes a lot of patience to be able to do so.
Yeah, for a school to really stick in jiu-jitsu, it needs to have that sort of family thing, and to establish that from scratch is really challenging.
Very much so.
Because to get people to move over from maybe the one of the other satellite schools, or from maybe the headquarters or whatever, usually people train near where they live,
right,
and the core of the group is going to feel very loyal to the initial place. So you're usually starting with a lot of newer guys, mostly white belts, maybe some blue belts. Occasionally you have guys that haven't trained in a while, then they see a school pop up near their house, and the blue or purple comes in. But you're really establishing that family unit from scratch, and it's an uphill battle.
It's incredibly difficult, because just in the culture itself, leaving your school, someplace where you've spent a lot of time in, it's like a nasty, nasty divorce.
Bad.
It hurts. It hurts very bad. Even though you know, you 100% know that it's time to go or time to move on for one reason or another, it hurts. And I see it all the time. And it's a process that a lot of guys that come to my school that have left other schools, and I see them going through the same process that I went through. Man, it takes years sometimes to just let the baggage go and move on. It's something unique to jiu-jitsu, and you know, I can't explain it.
It is. And I don't think it even just comes from, you know, the Brazilians calling crayonche, whatever, by using this this novella term of somebody that's very dishonest, or, you know, kind of speaks, you know, says one thing and does another. I think that term came up because of the phenomenon itself, because it's a family,
right?
And then by, like you call it, it's like a nasty divorce. So I feel like that term came up, and those strong feelings came up because of the actual structure itself,
right,
and not the other way around. It's not just, oh, because the Brazilians say you're not supposed to do it. Like,
right.
Yeah, great. We do a lot of things that other countries say don't do. But yeah, you're breaking up a family. It's or you know, people move, jobs
right.
change, lots
right.
of things happen.
Right. Right.
I think there's a difference between, you got guys that just jump on Yelp and they want to, you know, just get the best deal and, you know, hop from school to school year after year. That's not the same thing.
No.
If you're out of school, you know, 5-10 years and then leaving, like, this is a big deal.
Right. Right. Which is what happened to me, because after I left Michael Jenna, I finally settled in with my instructor, Marco Nascimento, who's a good guy. And I got my purple belt from him, you know, and that's 7 years that I stayed there. And it was during this time that the idea for my school kind of came about. I was teaching at the police academy at the time. I was a blue belt, and people just kind of commented, hey, you know, I really like the way you teach. I like your style. You really, you get the thoughts across. You kind of, you organize the content well. And a lot of them came up to me and said, hey, would you be willing to help me out here in the academy, teach me some defensive tactics to help me make it through? And 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and then all of a sudden I've got a small group that are wanting to train with me, you know, once, twice a week, when, you know, during the academy off hours. And I started thinking, I go, wow, you know, this is something that may have some bite and maybe a little traction. So that's how the idea started. And I guess that's where the conflict began with my current instructor. And the conflict really wasn't that I was teaching. I think the conflict was more like, he's very old school, and he had the very strong belief that you cannot teach jiu-jitsu unless you're a black belt. Hmm. And, you know, he said that several times, and I can respect that. You know, I can respect that opinion and that point of view. And it just got to the point where my students were doing really well. My students had been training with me for a couple of years and doing really well at tournaments. They were winning good major tournaments, and yet I couldn't get the recognition or the rank to be able to, or the ability to promote them to blue belt after several years. And it just really, I left because of my students. My students were the ones that motivated me, because I wanted to do something for them that I felt they deserved, and I couldn't do it under my current situation. My instructor just, you know, basically said, and he was, I appreciated his honesty. I mean, he just said, listen, you're not a black belt, you can't teach jiu-jitsu, you can't promote your students. So, you know, it was that time, as we talked about the nasty divorce, you know, I walked out, and my last words were, or what he told me was, hey, listen, you're leaving the academy as a man, you can come back as a man. Which, because I spoke to him in person and kind of laid it all out for him, and we had a heart-to-heart conversation, and that's essentially where it ended. And I walked out, and man, you walk away, and I have a school. Now I have a small school that I'm with a group of students that I had, where I had already moved. I started renting out space, and then I ended up getting my own place. And so financially, I'm on the hook here. I've got not just the financial aspect, but I have my students that I have to take care of and guide and mentor. And all of a sudden, that cape that I was wearing that had the logo on it just kind of flew off. Now it's gone. What the hell do I do now? You know? And for a couple months, it was rough. It was like a ship without a sail. And I kind of didn't know what to do. I had reached out to a couple of people, to a couple of associations, and they never answered me. Sent out an email, called, they never answered me. which I think it's just kind of meant to be that then out of nowhere, one of my old friends, she used to train with me at my old school, and she moved to Dallas. She was a personal chef, and she ended up moving to Dallas with this very wealthy family who she cooked for, and she was training with Carlos Machado in Dallas. And the family would travel from Dallas to Los Angeles, and she would follow them. And when she was in LA, she would go to Jean-Jacques. And so she came by my school one time, and I said, you know, here I am. And she's like, you know what? You need to call Jean-Jacques. Give him a call. Tell him what you want to do. They're really good people down there. You know, I've met a lot of them. Tough school, good people. Call them. They're world class. I said, okay. So I go on the website. It says affiliation. It says for contact Jay Zabalos. Here goes the email. Send the email, man. Next day, I get an email back. And I'm like, whoa, right away. I'm like, okay. A couple days later, I was in a car driving down to LA. I said, I can't do this over the mail. If I'm going to commit to something, I really need to know what it's like. So within 5 days, I'm down in LA. I'm having lunch with Jay. We're talking about my goals. He's talking about their goals. And it's just starting to match. It's kind of like, wow, this is great. So it's like, come to the academy. So I get to the academy. Here comes Jean-Jacques. And then, you know, you talk about getting starstruck. I mean, here I am. I'm a purple belt. I'm a nobody, right? And I'm sitting I'm sitting there. I'll never forget my first day at that academy. So you've been there. You know it is. They have two doors. You go in and then you come out and it goes into the changing room. I remember sitting there as a purple belt. And I'm sitting there and I see a guy walk in and you size the guys up, right? So I'm like, look, okay, all right. I think I can take this guy. He walks in. Walks out, he's a black belt. Crap, I can't take him. Okay, so I sit there and another guy walks in. Another black belt walks out. And then a guy walks in. And next thing you know, there's like 12 black belts on the mat, about 6 brown belts, and everyone else is a purple belt. I'm going, oh my God, what have I gotten myself into? And there's nowhere to run.
No.
There's nowhere to go. And Jean-Jacques walks in, and then I had a great time. Everyone was very helpful. I got to meet people. And it's amazing because a lot of the people that were on the mat were people I'd watch YouTube videos of. When I was a white belt, you know, I'd watch YouTube videos of Jean-Jacques rolling with Eddie. You know, you'd see these guys like Mark Armstrong, and then he'd demo stuff on Mark, and you'd see these guys on YouTube, and all of a sudden they're there, and Jean-Jacques is talking to me, and then he rolls with me. Very first day I'm there, that guy rolls with me. Now, mind you, my old instructor, you know, a black belt was a very revered thing, and it was very rare for you to come in contact with a roll or even train with a black belt. Yep. And so when that happens, you begin to kind of hold back a little bit, like, oh my God, it's a black belt. You know, instead of just training with the person, you start training with the belt.
Oh, yeah. I already know what you're going to say you did, and you made a terrible mistake because I did it with him too. I pulled guard and I rolled with him at the seminar at your gym when you got your black belt. I pulled guard and I could tell him I immediately made a terrible mistake.
Oh, that guy, well, first of all, I mean, he's an amazing man overall. He's in amazing shape. He mows black belts down daily. I mean, he trains with all of his students. He doesn't shy away from any of them. He trains with all visitors when they come in. He wants to train with all of them. He doesn't shy down from that. And every move you do with him is wrong.
Yeah.
Every move you do is wrong. Every position you take, and almost like the rules don't apply to him. For example, when you see someone's back, you can typically take it. Mm-hmm. If you see it, you can take the back, except for him. He'll show you the back, and when you move there, it's not going to be there anymore. I can't explain it, but every move he does is just good, and it's perfect, and he doesn't really, really even try. And I think that just comes from a life of just living jiu-jitsu. You know, that's his big thing, is I live jiu-jitsu. A lot of people have trained jiu-jitsu for many, many years, but to sit down with Jean-Jacques and listen to him talk about how jiu-jitsu essentially defined his life from birth all the way to now, it's very different. It's different when you play at something or you study something versus when you live something. And that is the biggest difference, I think, with him. And many superheroes will let you down.
Oh, yeah.
You know, many superheroes will let you down. You'll read about these great champions And then you sit down with them, and after a couple of minutes, or for whatever reason, the flaws will begin to come out, and you'll start to go, wow, you know, this isn't really how I pictured how this guy is, one way or the other, whether it's good or bad or different. But with Jean-Jacques, I mean, he's a genuine, genuine dude. I'm a skeptic. I'm a cop. I don't trust anybody. You know, that's just my nature. But the man is just amazing. He didn't have to do anything for me. He didn't have to, but he treated me like I'm his long lost son from the very first day I met him. And it's never wavered over the last 3.5 years, which to me is amazing. He's Jean-Jacques Machado. He doesn't have to look in my direction, but he treats me like I'm his best friend and like I'm his family. And that's what amazes me. So from nowhere, now I'm in this fold. And one of the greatest lessons I learned from that is, it's not your physical skill that really takes you, because everyone, and I mean everybody, has the same ability to gain content, knowledge. It's all on YouTube. Everything is there. It's what's in your mind. It's how you believe in yourself and how you can apply what you know. And that's the difference. The difference is the mentor. The difference is the someone who can drive you forward instead of just kind of being by your side and kind of just hanging out. When Jean-Jacques gets behind you and he pushes you and he kicks you and he pushes you, then he gets in front of you, he shows you how to do it, then he gets behind you and then he pushes you again forward to do exactly what he does. And he does that to everybody, which is the most amazing thing. And man, I can't say enough about that guy. And Professor J, congratulations, by the way, Professor J, for just getting your third degree black belt.
Nice.
I call him the apprentice. He lives and breathes and he exudes the ways of Jean-Jacques Machado out to everyone in a way that doesn't overwhelm you. It's just he leads by example. And it's amazing. I couldn't be more proud to be part of such an organization. And man, to get that black belt from somebody you used to watch on YouTube as a white belt, I mean, that's just crazy.
Yeah, it was definitely an emotional day for you. The seminar was amazing. I mean, it costs what seminars do. So if you abstract, if you were to look at the nuts and bolts of what we did in the seminar, mm-hmm. there wasn't like a whole topic. Usually people go and they have like a thesis, right?
Right.
We're working on this because I did this in Worlds and yada yada something. Mm-hmm. He came and he sits down and you can just tell this guy is a very high caliber human being.
Right.
The calm, the way he approaches people, the way he makes you feel comfortable immediately. Right. But the entire thing was Q&A.
Yeah.
And if that was anyone else, people would have complained. But every question, and when you have that type of format, it's mostly going to be white and blue belts that are going to ask the questions, because right. they've got 1,000 of them. And I think a lot of the more advanced belts are kind of shy about sounding stupid, you know, in front of the lower belts. I go, yeah, come on.
Yeah.
I clearly know everything. I'm a black belt. It's like, I don't know anything. I'm a white belt again.
Right.
I'm a black belt, but I'm a white belt again.
No.
So it was Q&A and, you know, and people talk about, okay, the drop ins at the gym, they're, mm-hmm. they are more expensive than other gyms, but then we learned a Kimura, right? When I dropped in there 2 or 3 weeks ago with these guys, I learned a Kimura. And if you were to say that to anyone else, you're like, you paid what for? No. I have been finishing everyone I've rolled with that Kimura.
Yeah.
I didn't know the Kimura before.
Right.
I thought I did.
Right.
But it's just that level of instruction, the level of knowledge. He flies under the radar because he's a very humble, yeah. you know, very... you know, just sort of he has his gym in LA, he does his seminars, right. he has his affiliations, but you know, the most you hear is about from you know, Eddie and Joe right. Rogan about what kind of human being he is,
right.
and what kind of instructor. And you know, for those two guys, like as martial artists, it's like, okay. And then you look closer and you're like,
yeah.
wait a minute, Chuck Norris, didn't he get right. his from mm-hmm. and oh, he learned that there.
Mm-hmm.
And you roll with some of the students, your students the same, and everybody's solid. They're from, you know, white belt through black belt. He has killers there. They're all very
right.
nice.
Right.
They're all very respectful.
Incredibly, yeah.
It's a very safe place. Like, you're not going to get tuned up and hurt.
No.
You're going to learn.
Yes.
You're going to get beat up, but you're going to learn.
Yes.
Absolutely. It's an amazing story. And you don't hear a lot of associations that have that sort of bond between instructors and stuff. I mean, I liken many of them to like a more of like a restaurant franchise. Like, you got the name and brand and stuff, and I've never seen this before, like this type of relationship. So it's actually really cool.
It's very unique. One of the things that we do is, they're really big on association training. So, one of the bigger schools is Matt Baker's school in Bakersfield. You talk about the guy that flies under the radar.
Okay.
Matt Baker, third degree black belt. Jean-Jacques Machado is the number one ranked. I think he's number one or number two ranked master male, master three in the IBJJF. And you never hear about this guy. He's amazing. He does some amazing stuff. And he has one of the biggest, he has two schools in Bakersfield. And so what often happens is we have these affiliation trainings where everybody just gets together and we'll have 100, 150 people on the mat from other places. And the reason for that, of course, is to roll. But Jean-Jacques and Jay always say, hey, families that are spread out across the world, across the nation, how do they reconnect? You have family gatherings. You have your barbecues. This is our family barbecue. This is a time for us to get to know each other and come together as a family. And so it's really cool. And what a lot of people don't understand with the history of jiu-jitsu and with Jean-Jacques Machado is that Jean-Jacques Machado defines his jiu-jitsu in two ways. He did jiu-jitsu before Hicks and Gracie, and then there's his jiu-jitsu after Hicks and Gracie.
Okay.
And so Jean-Jacques, when he was still in high school, and he doesn't remember when exactly or how it happened, but Jean-Jacques told me that Hickson started asking him to come to his school to take private lessons. So Jean-Jacques would literally take the bus to Hickson and meet Hickson like 6 or 7 in the morning, and this happened for many, many years. And so Jean-Jacques, credits a lot of what he learned and how he looked at jiu-jitsu because of his one-on-one interactions, his private lessons with Hicks and Gracie. And he doesn't know why. He says, he just treated me like a younger brother or even a son, and just had me invited me. He doesn't invite people. He invited me. And it was those years that he said was formative to how his jiu-jitsu excelled. And another thing that I thought was really interesting, if you ask any of the Machado brothers who their instructors were, they will always cite that their instructors were themselves. So you have a group of brothers who really pushed each other and taught each other, much like what we do. Yes, I have my instructor here, but really I learned the most from my students, my peers, the guys that I train with, the guys I pull off to the side and say, hey, what do you think about this position? Let's do this. Let's do that. And I think it's that type of thinking and that type of mentality with the Machado brothers, where they credit each other with helping their games elevate, that it's that their associations and their schools are less cultish.
Okay.
Because there's no head person that they can really attribute their growth to. They grew with the community, which I think is somewhat unique, in jiu-jitsu culture, where they credit themselves, the brothers, all the same rank, as teaching each other, helping each other from white to blue all the way through. And I think, and there was something that Alvaro Mansoor...
The red belt, yeah.
Yeah, no, I'm sorry, not Alvaro. Alvaro Mansoor, the head ref for U.S. Open and Claudio's teacher. Yeah, that's Francisco's the red belt.
Okay,
right? Francisco's the red belt. Okay. Alvaro, I talked to him one time and he said, "Oh, Jean-Jacques," I said, "Yeah, I'm a black belt with Jean-Jacques. I train with Jean-Jacques." Big smile goes over his face and he goes, "Oh man, he's an old friend." He goes, "Oh, I knew him when I had hair," and he. And he said, please give him a big hug for me. And then he said something to me that really stuck. He says, Jean-Jacques Machado is the black belt's instructor. He said he is the black belt instructor. So, you know, you're not just an instructor, you're a black belt instructor. And man, how amazing was that for me to just even be associated with him and have him push me. I mean, a simple thing, he likes your Instagram post.
Yeah.
Everyone likes it. the big thumbs up or the big, and he does little things like that. And it seemed meaningless to a lot of people. Not, I shouldn't say meaningless, but they shouldn't say it doesn't carry much weight, but to a struggling business, to someone that's really struggling to get their name out, to know that he's there just liking your post, man, it does wonders for your confidence.
Oh, every time I've posted anything related to, you know, visiting or anything like that, there's always the thumbs up or the fist little emoji.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, it's cool stuff. It's made my day both times. I think he did it, like, I posted two pictures, once from when Jerry, we were there with Jerry at your seminar, yeah, your promotion, and then once when we dropped in. And yeah, he's a solid guy. I mean, yeah, the barbecue you talked about in Bakersfield, we just had one kind of yesterday at the academy that I'm with, and we don't have many affiliations at all. We have Portland Judo, PDX, BJJ, and then what's Mikey's school?
It's Butte, Montana.
In Butte, Montana, we have one there. It's one of our brown belts, and then AKA Sunnyvale, which is it's a One World kind of, it's One World Jiu-Jitsu. It's a guerrilla affiliate, mm-hmm, but we're all under Mike Prudencio, so it's a small family. It's
right.
There's a lot of people, but it's a family. Right. We don't have the a lot of schools do promotions in different ways. We kind of have a summer party once a year, and that's when it is. And we don't have stripes or anything like that. And every once in a while, there's the random belt, like when it's very obvious, but it's seldom.
Sure.
So you know, I just got my black belt yesterday, so I'm still not, it's not real right yet.
Big congratulations, by the way.
Thanks.
This is awesome.
In just 12 short years, you know, it's, you too can be.
I'm the same way.
Clearly.
So the, just a quick note on the black belt. So, the powers of invisibility kick in after about a week.
Okay.
And flight is about 6 months out. You'll be able to fly in about 6 months.
I see. I thought so. I was waiting for that one. I woke up this morning and I was looking to see if my hair came back, and
that me
did,
too.
That did not happen. And yeah.
But, you know, the being a new black belt and you too, what it did for me, it was funny because I got promoted on a Saturday, and then on Sunday, I was on a plane to Dallas, Texas. No, to Austin. And when I got to Austin, I had training there for work. And then I went and I trained at a Jacques Machado Austin, which is run by Todd White and Mark Armstrong. Okay. Two very, very good third-degree black belts. A third and a second-degree black belt. And my first role as a black belt, I got tapped by a blue belt.
Oh,
yeah.
Lovely.
And you know what that did for me? It's like, wow, I really am starting over. And I had a bad day. My very first role, blue belt, I got tapped. I was like, what is going on? And it refocuses you. So the black belt really is a new beginning. And that for me just symbolized, okay, I'm starting all over again. And you redo your basics. You think about your basics. You will see this. When you do teach, you're gonna have a tendency to go right back to your basics. It's gonna flow right back in, because it's a feeling of renewal and starting over. It's like, you know, basics done at a high level is truly, truly the advanced man's art.
Absolutely, I feel like a lot of guys go out of their way to sort of teach their classes in a way that it's almost like entertainment. They're like, I got to show a new thing. Yeah. No, it should be deliberate. What you show should, there should be reason for it. It should be part of a, you know, a larger system. There's you know, fundamentals in every sort of school's curriculum. There should be.
Right.
For me, I pay a lot of attention to closed guard and sort of, for the simple reason of Brazilian jiu-jitsu or Gracie jiu-jitsu, whatever we're calling it, it was kind of developed around the idea of sort of like the smaller guy can use leverage to their advantage and use space to their advantage. And if they don't really understand close guard, and it's not just, so I'll have guys do a guard pass drill, just positional stuff, right? So we'll start in close guard pass drill, and I'll say go. And what guys used to do would, they'd break and immediately go to De La Hiva with Spider. And I'm like, okay, pretend there's no YouTube.
Right.
Let's just talk about why we're doing this and what we're trying to accomplish. So the guy on the bottom, he wants more guard.
Right.
And the guy on the top wants less.
Right.
Here's why. And I try to break it down and say, like, let's look at a little bit of grip stuff. And we'll go back to a little bit of this is where posture kind of should be.
Yeah.
Here's hand position. Now let's do it again, and just keep in mind, like, this is kind of the strategy that I want you to employ when you're doing this drill, and don't do things just to kind of do them.
Right.
Sort of, there should be a method to the madness.
Right.
Like, there should be a reason you're doing what you're doing. If I don't have to open my guard, I don't. Why?
Yeah.
And I think it's lost on a lot of, I think people don't even think about it. They just try to do the pretty thing or the fancy thing. And
every movement must be preceded by a fundamental reason. There has to be a fundamental reason for every movement you do. Otherwise, you're just moving.
Yeah, absolutely. I hear, you know, you get a lot of, you know, the no-gi guys, and there's a lot of space. And in that, you, the closed guard, that's, if you look at the whole rubber guard system, it's the overhook with the clinch.
Right.
They ladder up into that high guard.
Mm-hmm.
And they've got cool names for everything. They have very precise, you know, movements and everything. But really, they're all deliberate, and they're all based on not having that chaos happen.
Right.
So, I mean, to me, the scramble is something that, it's for the guy that doesn't know the next move.
Right.
I don't get into chaotic situations if I don't have to. I want to, you know, mitigate risk and do move deliberately and thoughtfully and kind of not get killed.
Yeah. Especially in no-gi. I think a lot of people, one of the first things I tell my students when we do no-gi, no-gi is a distance game. This is about distance control.
Mm-hmm.
It is 100% distance control.
Absolutely.
And you have to learn how to control that distance before you can do anything else. And that's the overhook, you know, the evolution of the Junjaku, the overhook with Junjaku in his left hand. And, you know, go, and one of the awesome things, and you mentioned close guard, about being affiliated with Junjaku is when you listen to him tell stories about way back, you know, you get a glimpse on how they originally meant jiu-jitsu to be. For example, he commented one time, he says, my uncle used to tell me, that's probably Carlos, that you get someone in your close guard, you take out your samurai sword and you start chopping them up. You kill them in your close guard.
Yep.
He goes, there's no escape. Once they're in your close guard, you take out your sword and you start chopping them in half. And, you know, a lot of times that's lost. A lot of times that's lost. One more thing he told me was, you want to practice self-defense in your jiu-jitsu every day? Anytime anyone puts a hand in your collar, you've just been punched in the face.
Absolutely.
Don't let anyone put the hand in your collar. So if you do those two simple things, look to kill someone in the guard, in the close guard, and defend the hand going to your collar, you're blocking punches, and you're breaking people's posture. Those are the two foundations of self-defense. So you can do self-defense in your everyday role just by remembering those two things. You can add an element of it.
Oh, absolutely. I do not yield to grips. I am proactive, and it can be the most boring role. I don't yield to them. I break every damn one. I'm playing my game, and I the minute someone gets a hold of your collar, a lot of guys are like, oh, I'm just going to pass anyway. No, the position changed.
Right.
The leverage is different. The movement is different. You can't proceed that way, and here's 150 reasons why you just got tapped.
Right. Like,
you have to, you know, every move should be deliberate, and you're going to keep going through, you know, one of these guard passes, and they have one of the, what is this, like the spider guard, the leg, the lasso and everything.
Right.
Guys keep going, they get, you know, bicep sliced or sucker swept or whatever, and just a simple example that guys just do things.
Yeah.
Because there's so, YouTube's, it's great and it's terrible.
Yeah.
It's great and it's terrible, and it's cool because creativity, and there's so many different moves that you can learn, and but they apply to very specific situations.
Sure.
Very specific, and guys want to force them.
Yeah.
And some can.
No.
Some can. There's going to be the freak athletes, and congratulations. this thing happens called turning 40. When that all goes away. You really hope you worked on good fundamentals. You really hope your guard, your grip defense, your posture, how you use space, that you're aware of your space.
Right.
The wrestlers have it. They have a little advantage going in if they can learn jiu-jitsu.
Right.
They know to defend their legs, not just sprawl because they do it on UFC or something.
Right.
But you're defending your legs deliberately, and just like we defend collars, right?
Mm-hmm.
So if they learn jiu-jitsu and use it, not just wrestle with chokes, because I think they're very different things.
Very much so. Very much so. And so much of that is missing, like the teaching of the situational change. You talked about people forcing positions. Is that, man, jiu-jitsu is a moment by moment thing, and situations and positions will change moment to moment. What makes a good jiu-jitsu player is their adjustments to the changes, not just their ability to adjust, but their ability to analyze the adjustment. And that's why, and I think so much of that just comes from experience. And you know, with regards to YouTube and people trying to force positions and looking at things, when you do jiu-jitsu over a long period, over a decade, like you and I have, you go through evolutions yourself. You will go through certain evolutions, and you will hit a phase where you're hitting arm drags, and then you're going to hit a phase where you're hitting X guard, and you're going to hit a phase when you're doing this, and then you'll kind of forget about it, then you kind of revert back to it, then you forget about it, then you revert back to it, and then what happens is it's just like a mind melt. Now it's like a soup, right? And now it's just all available for you, just whenever you want it. Just pick the right ingredient. And a lot of people that are 1 or 2 years in don't understand that. They don't understand that they're going to evolve and change. Their injuries will change their game.
Yeah.
Knee injury, back injury, shoulder injury, neck injury. It will change the way your game, and it will mold your game. Your moods, the phase you are in your life, all that stuff will change. And when I tell people to be patient, sometimes it's kind of lost on them because they want it now. But I can tell you that, you know, at least for me, I was probably the worst white belt on the mat for many, many years in my schools. And the only reason I got a black belt is because I hung around. And that's really the only secret. I mean, was there a secret to you getting your black belt?
Let's see. I trained every day. I've been teaching for 5 years. I used to be on the mat up to 10 times a week. Because I wanted to be there. After the day I got my purple belt, I realized it was a different thing now.
Yeah.
That I wasn't ever going to have that anticipation feeling of like, oh, am I going to get promoted? That Christmas present feeling, right?
Right.
I'm 33 years old now, and you don't get many of those, but it's nice having things to look forward to.
Sure.
So, and so even on Friday, everybody's like, you think you can get promoted? I'm like, God. I don't, at some point.
That is exactly the time you get promoted, when you stop caring. Not that you stop caring, when you stop thinking about it.
Like, it's going to happen at some point. Like, well, they're just going to forget I'm there, or, you know, I can't be that bad. I mean,
right.
At some point, you know, you're not going to be a brown belt anymore. If you're there all the time, it's like, all right, this guy. I mean, you know, am I a world champion? No. I'm competent. I feel I'm a better instructor than competitor for sure.
Yeah.
But, you know, ultimately you get there. And the hardest thing to tell somebody that's, you know, very motivated or isn't patient is to be patient.
Right.
It's so counterproductive, but it's the best. It's the only information you got. I try to come up with you know, different euphemisms or different analogies. They don't want your analogies. They want their damn blue belt.
Just give me my blue belt.
Just give me the damn blue belt.
That was the same way. I just wanted a blue belt. Then I got my blue belt. Then I hung around. Then I got a purple belt. And it was right a purple belt, just like you said, when I figured out, you know what? I'm going to get my black belt because I'm going to hang around. They're not going to get rid of me.
Oh, yeah. It seems so far-fetched. I'm like,
I know.
Wow, you know, it's, you know, 10 years to do something. That's like, that's undergrad plus a PhD in a lot of cases.
Right,
I mean, I could have went back and been a physicist, but I think jiu-jitsu instructor and like a physicist make about the same money, unless you open 100 gyms or something. I don't know.
You forgot life coach.
Oh, life coach. What about movement coaches?
There you go.
Those guys are they're hot right now because of Connor.
Yeah, no touch butt.
No touch butt in the park, man. Did you even get to watch UFC 201?
No, man. I am just so busy. I mean, it, you know, I it, I'm 45 years old. I quit my job as a police officer, running my school full time. I got four kids, man. I am just up to my neck in it, and you know, my school's my last hustle. So this is it. This is it. It's all hustle. So unfortunately, I don't have much time for, you know, for doing that. But tell me about it.
No, I'm asking because this is not the MMA show. MMA guy in here today. I didn't get a chance to. We were just wrapped up in the promotion thing. And it was, you know, by the time we put in a good 2 hours of, you know, rolling before, and it was that I spent the day. I saw people I hadn't seen in a very long time. It's expected to, you know, go out after, and
right.
We had food there, and it was a really good time. I was pretty sure that Tyrone Woodley was going to take the welterweight title.
Okay, yeah.
And he did.
Yeah, yeah.
And Matt Brown, I think he lost a pretty tough fight as well. But besides, I don't know the results other than that. Spoiler alert, I mean, who cares? I think it's amazing that Robbie Lawler was, you know, made it back to sort of the prominence and really got the most out of his career and got the title in the UFC.
Yeah.
I'm more interested in the police stuff, though,
okay.
Man.
Yeah, talk to
20
me.
20 years. I have, and you see everything on social media right now, and there's this big divide. I believe it's a media creation. Mm-hmm. I feel like, and nothing but love and support to the military, but if you join the military, you go overseas, you come back, you're a hero. But if you're a police officer, you're here, you are one of the people,
right?
And then you got half the Facebook and the whatever, Twitter and the Instagram, they look at you like you're somehow demonized, like you're
right.
You're not one of the people, like you're part of this infrastructure that's
sure.
So it's just a weird thing. It's a weird vibe right now. I really believe that it's somehow media sort of generated stuff, and I feel like there's things that can be done to remedy that, and I don't quite understand why it's not taught in schools, why it's not pushed that, like, hey, everybody wants it, like all the politicians talk about,
right.
Let's make domestic right inside the, mm-hmm. the borders of America great, and like that's what you guys are here kind of doing,
right?
And I don't quite see the logic and the difference, and I don't get why every TV show kind of paints these two very opposing pictures about two, you know, these,
right.
The external versus internal defense or whatever. But
it's let me tell you, you know, it's never, at least in my career, I've never seen it this bad, the anti-police sentiment. And you know, it really is unfortunate because you have a lot of really good guys out there and girls that do an amazing job day in and day out, don't get one complaint. And, you know, I forgot what the statistics were, but over 1 million contacts a day and not a complaint, no use of force. And then you have the one incident that just takes over. And I believe it's because of the social media age that all of a sudden people have something to cling on to. It's truly unfortunate, but I can tell you this. My last 9 years of my career, well, the last 5 years of my career, I supervised the unit that, well, first of all, let me just go back a little bit. In the DA, in the district attorney's office, our job is to investigate police officers. That's what we do. We investigate them for crimes. Not when people say, oh, so you do IA. No, I don't do IA. IA is for police misconduct that doesn't rise to the level of a crime. For example, a cop has sex with his girlfriend on duty in the car,
okay.
Has her come on a ride along. It's not criminal. Yes, it's conduct unbecoming. That's an internal affair investigation. I'm talking about cops that commit burglaries, cops that commit rape, cops that steal on duty. Those are the types of cases that we investigated. And toward the end of my career, I supervised the unit that looked at officer-involved shootings.
Okay.
So we interviewed the officers that actually shot people. I can tell you this, that not one of the officers I've ever interviewed who's ever been involved in an officer-involved shooting that took someone's life was ever happy about it.
No.
As a matter of fact, they were changed people afterwards. And I'm talking about one officer shot a 14-year-old black kid. Oh. Another officer shot a mentally disturbed 18-year-old Hispanic female. So, you know, these aren't your random shootings. These are shootings that could could potentially generate a, and I don't know if we're just fortunate in the county that I live in that we have a very high level of professionalism, but it's just unfortunate that they have to now pay the price, or all law enforcement officers will pay the price for, you know, the act of a few.
I feel like you guys, in a lot of cases, a lot of the beat cops or, you know, patrol officers, and just they're not prepared for the worst. I mean, okay, so if you go to a traffic stop, you have to be prepared for the worst in terms of you know, what could they do? Could they be armed if you don't see hands on the wheel? It's like, well, you're obviously going to have your weapon at least unclipped.
Right.
God forbid you have to actually use it. But right. I feel like if you have to prepare for that in terms of the traffic stop, but you're not armed with enough information going into it.
Right.
I feel like the license plate, it can only possibly give you arrest information, warrant, stolen car. Then if you have time to run the owner's stuff, which mm-hmm. I don't think that's even possible, but there's other things that are kind of blocked by weird sort of, and I'm not saying weird, I believe that medical privacy is important, but I believe that certain things in someone's medical history mm-hmm. could trigger red flags that could save lives had that information been, like in the case of somebody that does have a mental illness or a history of aggression,
that may not have led to
some sort of police involvement. What about like schizophrenic?
Right.
Many of these things where if you were armed with that information ahead of time, you might have been able to save a life or prevent a death or prevent something terrible from happening. And I'm not saying get rid of HIPAA. I'm not saying get rid of all the medical privacy stuff, in fact. But the part of it that could make getting a weapon more difficult for somebody that really shouldn't have it, I believe there should be like a point system, for example, like 5-10 points, like where if this number of things are you know, maybe a history of violence, some kind of various types of crimes, a combination of them, or types of medication, or maybe you've been hospitalized for this, that, or the other things of them, there could be a scoring system where it's like if you're over this number, you're just not getting it. You can appeal it, but you're not getting it right now for sure. And I think by poking little holes that don't necessarily have to give all the picture, but enough to where at a traffic stop you'll have faster access to the information. And I feel like that's part of it. And another, I heard a podcast, and it was either Joe Rogan or Joey Diaz. I remember I was up in Seattle and I was listening to Big John McCarthy. Mm-hmm. He comes from a police mm-hmm. family. He's ex police himself. And he was talking a lot about, you know, people that are, you know, the officers that are, you know, the patrol officers, they're being trained because the system sort of, it's not as glamorous to want to stay in the patrol. People want the shield. They want to be a detective. Right. They want to, you know, they want to move up because they watch the TV shows. Sure. They have Blue Bloods. They have whatever. There's 1,000 of them, right? Even The Flash is a police show.
Yeah.
Right?
Right.
So people want to move up the ladder, and you're having a lot of junior officers with a couple months being trained by guys with only a couple of years, and you really don't have the time to bake in and really know who the hell you are, because coming right out of the academy, how old are these guys?
Yeah.
I mean,
I was 23.
And I'm sure you're the testosterone was not telling you to do things you shouldn't do. You didn't get mad. I mean, I'm at 33. I'm like, oh God, that guy last year, what an asshole.
Right.
I'm wrong all the time.
Right.
And that that you grew up in a good household and there was nothing traumatic that happened as a child, or that you weren't even aware of, or just things like this. Like, people have their own individual lives and stories, and who the hell knows what someone grows up with and like, or why they're becoming an officer.
Right.
People, I got bullied in school, and you know, fuck that, I'm gonna get them all back.
Yeah.
Like it's never happened, right?
Sure. Yeah.
You know, lots of, or whatever reason, but I feel like if there was somehow more incentive for guys to stick around longer.
Right.
And to really, and that it was the training aspect was really focused on. Like, I know the Gracies do the training thing. Our friend Dave there went and got to train with Henner and Heron, the police training, and which sounds pretty awesome. But
you know, and it's a physical. So here's the thing. One of the things that I've developed my expertise on the last couple of years is use of force, and I've police uses of force. I've testified as an expert several times, and I've been to all kinds of trainings, and the one thing that really stands out is the deficiency of training in the police, deficiency of ongoing police training when it comes to defensive tactics. The problem is, it's tough to explain, but so we spoke earlier about our friend in workers' comp and about how the workers' compensation and about the injuries. So the problem is in-service police personnel are so injury prone because they're so out of shape that if you were going to have any type of meaningful ongoing defensive tactics training, they're going to get injured. So the injury rates rise. So now here you are as a police agency, you're watching injury rates rise. As the injury rates rise, you're paying out. You're paying out. That's costing you money. Yeah. Every injury on a police officer, they're off the street. Now it's costing you money. Workers' comp insurance kicks in, all this stuff. So as a police agency, you're saying, whoa, 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 wait a second. We're spending too much money. So now the bureaucrats in the city are going to say, we're going to have less of that training. So then it begins to go down. That's the constant struggle. And that's with all types of training. And when it comes to training, let's say responding to an attack, it takes 1/8 of a second to hit somebody with a punch. 1/8 of a second. That is equivalent to a fastball at the major league level. Now imagine that you as an officer are the batter and the person is pitching at you and you have 1/8 of a second to make a decision whether to swing, not swing low, swing high. And most major league batters don't even see the ball when they're up there. They just swing, they just know where it is because of their training.
Muscle memory.
Muscle memory and their training. So now you have that problem in a case of an assault. The officer doesn't know what to do. The officer's ill-prepared. You are asked to perform at a major league level with nothing more than an eighth grade education.
Little league training.
That's exactly, and that is the common theme in almost all uses of force when it comes to police, when it comes to hands-on defense. Unfortunately, there are some that will go above and beyond. Like, you know, we have a lot of friends that train. I want you to do me a favor next time, go talk to some cops that you know and ask them if they can go get their buddies to train. They're not gonna do it. Cops are the laziest. And Dave knows this. They're the laziest, most excuse-filled bunch of people that they will make excuses not to train. They're horrible. They learning new skills. Oh, I don't need new skills. I'm good. Oh man, they're the worst. And I can say this because I've been teaching them for over 10 years. They're horrible.
I know a couple that do train. Great guys, mm-hmm. solid. I've had very similar conversations, most of them that make their way to the mats, they've gone through the real life job, and then they get on the mats and they're like, wait a minute, we as a police force, we have this level of training, but the civilians, they have access to this championship level, like what's on TV, what's the most popular thing, now how do I do that? All your friends, all the gangbangers or whatever, what are they watching?
Right.
You don't think somebody from the hood and whatever is oh man, we're gonna be just like him, blah blah blah.
See it all the time.
It's like how hard is it if you're a strong guy that knows how to throw a punch and somebody shoots on you, like how hard is it to get a guillotine against a guy that doesn't know what a guillotine is? Like, I know how to defend a guillotine, sure no problem. But I've been doing jiu-jitsu for almost 12 years, about 12 years, right? If you're carrying all this gear, the weapon, you're thinking to yourself, you're in fight or flight mode right now. You're like, what am I going to do? I discharge?
Right.
Do I tase? Do I try to, whatever? And you're in a guillotine choke. Think of the consequences now.
Right.
It's like, okay, we have a trained public. Right.
Sure.
They all know everything. I assume everybody knows everything. If someone is willing to start a fight, especially with a police officer, I assume they know everything, and they're going to bring some serious damage. You have to.
Right.
You have to assume that because what's the most popular thing on TV?
Right.
The most complete martial arts system that's ever been developed by humans. the most complete hand-to-hand combat system. Right. That's going to probably rub people with the Krav Maga thing the wrong way or whatever, but sure. I'm sorry, I have a television show that shows me that it's very effective.
Right.
And, you know, the more than one attacker thing, whatever. Yeah, he has friends, and they know how to throw head kicks, too.
Right.
Whatever. There's so much information out there, and it should be a crime that the people that are tasked with the job of protecting the public don't know it better. Not just, you know what I mean?
It's unfortunate. And, you know, I think the public fails to realize a lot of times that 100%, and I mean every single one, 100% of every call or every confrontation, every traffic stop that a police officer gets into is a man with a gun call. The police officer's gun is there. Every single one. A gun is introduced into every single call that a police officer responds to. And so when the altercation occurs, when the assault happens, there's the added element of the gun, the controlling of the gun. Can the gun be retained? Can it be taken away? And all kinds of other questions. So you want to complicate things even more? Throw that into the mix. It's kind of like that scene in Batman. I forgot what it was. And when the Joker, one of his guys got killed and said, you know, he goes, looks like we have an opening. Let's have tryouts. So he grabs the pool stick, he cracks it, throws it in the middle, and then all of a sudden the two guys go for the weapon and they fight. And so a lot of times, a lot of people tend to forget that. And so, you know, oh my God, you know, the cop wasn't in danger. The guy just punched him in the face. There's no big deal. Well, wait a second. There's a gun in the mix here that we have to worry about. Yep. You know, there's a million different things, but you're absolutely spot on. Undertrained, not enough information, always behind the curve. In every situation that they go into, they are always behind the curve because it's a reactive situation, and the cops are always reacting, always.
I know, and the my perspective, and I don't want to be misconstrued as a knock on any. I'm sure there are some divisions, some departments out there that have picked up on this information. They've got the buzz, or they went out and done it themselves. And there's a lot of individual officers that take the time and they go out and they know it's a job requirement. They get the budget and they go and they take the specialized training. And there's always those guys that go above and beyond.
Right.
This is not a knock on any police department or the police in general. I empathize with the job. I realize it's critical. I just believe that we as people need to step up a little bit. You got to figure out a way to show the positive stuff, not so much of this us and them stuff. And Morgan Freeman said, if you want to stop, you know, you want to get rid of racism, just stop talking about it. Stop labeling everything. And
yeah, I agree.
It's really unfortunate where things are right now and what they put on TV and what they... I got rid of cable a while ago. Once I hear that in the news today, I hear that accent,
right?
That affect or whatever you want to call it. I know I'm being lied to. I know I'm being pitched.
Yeah,
I can't do it. That's why I do this, because you have the information out there. You can research things on your own. You can make critical. You know, you can use critical thinking and say, okay, well, this is this drastic sort of step on this direction, there's some there's politics behind it. I wonder why. But this other point of view, it doesn't seem very reasonable either. It seems like they're directly in conflict over very specific things. It's weird. Maybe they're both full of crap, and maybe there's this middle point where people can be reasonable and come to an. It's like I just believe that there's a middle point where people just have to get together and kind of cut the crap. And we're talking about budgets,
right?
That you can't educate the force that's tasked with protecting the country here, not from drugs or terrorists, but from the country. There's so many people. Right. Cities are there's too many people. Yeah. Someone has to be there and has to be the voice of reason. And I think people have to start realizing that the police are people. Police go home. They live in the same neighborhoods. And
I think things would be much better if everybody just trained jiu-jitsu.
Clearly. We have a lot of training partners that are, they have all kinds of jobs. I know for me, from experience, that, you know, if I see blue and red lights behind me, I'm like, all right, well, better pull over and better not, you know, I better not run my mouth. My hands go on top of the steering wheel and whatever the hell he wants. Sure. What do you want? What do you, my license? It's over here. I'm going to reach for it now. This is easy stuff. If you don't go out of your way to be a jerk to him or be to sort of be the antagonist, and even if they're in a bad mood, try being empathetic. Maybe they're having a terrible day. I think in life, if I make it a priority to try to make the people around me feel more comfortable, my life's going to be better. Even selfishly, using empathy makes life better. So.
It's easy, man. Don't be a butthead.
It's a muscle. You have to exercise it, man. I believe empathy is a muscle. You have to train it and work it out. And I think if you just go out of your way to be nice instead of being a jerk.
Yeah, I agree.
Stuff will be better.
I agree. Peace and love, man.
Peace and love. Peace and love.
Peace, love, and jiu-jitsu.
Was that Ringo that said that?
I don't know.
No more. He didn't want any more fan mail. Was it Ringo or peace and love? Peace and love. No, they kept playing it as a thing on Howard Stern show.
I think I'm the oldest guy in the room, so
I don't know.
I'm 45. Who else is older than me? 41? Nah, I'm still older than you.
Sorry.
I know. It sucks.
All right, man. So you're at Peninsula Self Defense, and that's right. That's off of Bay Road, Redwood City.
2766 Bay Road, right off Woodside. We are right in the heart of everything, and you know, everybody come down. One of the things we do at the school is we make sure to take care of everybody. That's everybody's responsibility at the school, not just the people who run it. And, you know, we try to run the place the way I would like to have a school run, you know, had I been, you know, a white belt. And I just wish that more people had talked to me and done things for me. All those things, I made a list of things that I wish people had done for me when I was a white and a blue belt, and those are the things that I try to pass on to my students now, and it just really helps them just be better people. Better than being good to jiu-jitsu is being a good person. So
absolutely, eventually 40 happens. You better be good at some. Being a good person is first, man. Empathy is important. I say it to myself because I want to remind myself to try not to, you know, get too far ahead of myself, or, you know, just ego is a thing. You know, you got to shut it down sometimes and just come back to earth and be like, all right, come on, what are you doing? You're being silly. Yeah. But,
Have you tapped yet since you've...
Have
you been tapped yet since you got the black belt? No, have you tapped? Not did someone tap you. Have you tapped?
Have I tapped anyone?
No, have you tapped?
Oh, at all?
Yes.
No?
No.
Not yet. there's always some... Oh, yeah, I'll be on the mat tomorrow morning. I might actually drop into the 6:30 class just to say hello. So I teach the one on Wednesday and Friday, and the guys wanted a third day a week. I'm like, okay, cool. Well, Eric's got his purple belt, so this guy Eric Stang, his last name is actually Stang, and he's a beekeeper. He has like his own honey brand and everything. It's really good honey. It's organic. It's a good guy.
Good stuff.
So yeah, they wanted a third day. I'm like, yes, but I'm not doing it because Monday mornings, those are when I wake up early. I have a cup of coffee. I plan my week and write down, here's my goals. Here's this. I go through my notes. I go through my to-dos. And I got like three jobs, man. I teach jiu-jitsu. This thing is a job. I'm an engineering manager someplace out there in the ether. And so I used to work right behind your school at Silver Spring.
Okay, yeah.
I was there for a number of years.
Oh, nice.
That's an Al Gore-owned or partially owned company. He did Inconvenient Truth for us live there.
Really?
Yes. We thought we were going public, but it was Al Gore doing a live presentation of Inconvenient Truth.
Huh, interesting. Silver Spring Networks, right?
Yep.
You
definitely have their product at your home and at your business. Those power meters, right?
Yeah.
The smart grid solutions. Well,
I want that smart grid money.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. It's that mesh network. They're going to start using it for a lot of other stuff, too. I went to they gave some engineering talk a little while ago, and they want all your appliances talking to it as well. So they're going to start feeding information back.
More information.
Yeah, that's what it's going to be. It's going to be your dishwasher's going to walk out. It's going to be the first Terminator. What is it that comes online? Skynet? It's gonna be a bunch of dishwashers. It's not quite Schwarzenegger. We need a few hundred years in the future for that.
I'm Filipino. I don't believe in dishwashers. We do everything by hand, old school.
I have a dishwasher, but I'm like, that's a lot of work. Is I got to lift all that? I'll just wash it when I use it. All right. Well, I think we said a lot. I think we said it all. And
yeah.
You got a website?
I do. www.peninsulaselfdefense.com. Go check it out.
You guys have the best logo.
Yeah. Hey, do you know the logo?
It reminds me of a very old logo.
Tell me about it. What do you know about the logo?
It's the AWA from
it's
old.
It's the old AWA logo. Exactly. That's old, exactly where I got it from.
Old Vern Gagne.
Old Vern Gagne. And the reason behind that is I came here to this country in 1980 from the Philippines. I was 9 years old. And I'll never forget, I walked into my house. My grandpa was there. My grandpa grabs me by the arm, pulls me in front of the TV. The very first TV show I watched was AWA Wrestling. And he says, do you know what wrestling is? I'm like, nope. And I was hooked from that day. And every Sunday, me and my grandpa, Saturday and Sunday, me and my grandpa and my dad watch wrestling. And that damn AWA was on Coffee TV 20. And we would watch it in the 80s. And that's where I took the logo from. Very good. Not a lot of people know that.
The minute I saw it, I was like, he's got the AWA logo.
Very good.
Have you seen what Smash's Gym logo looks just like?
No, it's got the
Papa John's pizza.
That's true.
They've got the Papa John's logo. I saw that. I'm like, son of a, they really.
Oh, I'm going to talk to Michael about that.
It's not exactly it, but it's a very similar font. And I've used.
It's like McDonald's and McDowell's.
Coming to America. Coming to America. The Golden Arcs. Or the Golden Arches.
We've got the Golden Arcs.
That's it. All right, we said more than everything. So,
good knowledge, Clint.
Exactly.
Good knowledge.
I know everything about nothing, and vice versa too. Like we grew up watching Jeopardy, Wheel of Fortune. I'm watching this crap for 30 years, so I have not grown up. And I may or may not have been a luchador for a short period of time. I went through the training. I did the whole thing.
Oh, nice.
You can't do pro wrestling and jiu-jitsu full time.
No, your body will take it.
No, it's a terrible idea. All right, well, there's a cake out there. I hope there's still a piece of. So,
all right, bro.
Man, thanks for coming on. Right, it's been a pleasure.
That was fun. Thank you.
Awesome, man. Everybody, it's Eric Acha. Thanks.
Natural quanto a luz do dia, mas que preguiça boa, me deixa aqui à toa, hoje ninguém vai.